Good morning, everyone.
I think we can go ahead and get started for today. My name's Alex. I will be conducting today's webinar just like I do each and every week. For those of you that are new, welcome. For those of you that are returning, welcome back. Before we get started, I'll give you a little overview of how everything works. Up in your upper left corner, you should see an option for Q&A as well as an option for chat. If you have a question that you'd like to submit, please use the Q&A feature. It lets me keep track of all the questions, makes it very easy for me to make sure that I can answer all of them. So again, if you have a question, Q&A button, that's what it's for. If you have any comments or you want me to repeat something or if I'm going too fast or anything like that, by all means, utilize the chat feature and let me know. That's perfectly fine. But again, if you have any questions, go ahead and use the Q&A button and submit them that way. So to do kind of an overview of how things work, generally we have a specific topic that we cover for the first part of the webinar, and then we open it up to an open forum of questions. So, but what we're doing this week is kind of just a little break from everything, is we're just going to start straight up questions. So that's kind of the theme for today. So any questions that you have on your website, by all means, fire away, and I'll do my very best to answer them. So, again, if you have a question, go ahead and submit the Q&A button. I do see every question that comes in, so you don't have to resubmit them. You only have to submit your question once, so don't worry about having to send it in once over and over again. I answer the questions as they come in, so I start at the top of my list and work my way down. So just be patient. I will answer your question as soon as I can. So we'll kind of take it from there. All right. So the first question that came in: How do I get my website to come up in the top searches? Ian said that your website comes up more often, but I have put in all the phrases on each page of my website and put in the descriptions, but I cannot get my website to come up even when I'm trying by searching the phrases I have put in. That's an excellent question, and for those of you that don't know, that refers to what is called SEO for your website, that's search engine optimization. And I'll tell you straight out, I'm not an expert on SEO, but I will also tell you it's an extremely complicated thing. Just because you have a website, just because you have certain phrases, does not mean you're going to come up right away. It doesn't mean you're going to be in the top listings on the page. You might be, depending on what your phrase is, you could very easily be the 10,000th listing. It really depends, and it also takes time. Your website, if you set your website live, you're not going to be found later on that day. It's going to take time. It's a process. So as far as the direct question on what you can do, I'm not an SEO expert, so I don't have any specific tips that you can do to go through and optimize your site. It sounds like you've done what you needed to do. You put in the phrases on each of your page and your descriptions and your page titles. That's awesome. That's the great thing to do. That's the best way to start. There's also some information in the support portal on SEO that involves some general tips. Right here, search engine optimization, kind of gives you a little overview on what it actually is and some of the different things that you can do on your own to kind of help build that up for you. We also did a webinar not that long ago, so this is a number one resource to try, and I'll throw that link into the chat window there. We also did a webinar a while back where we had a member of our SEO team actually join us and kind of go through some of the basics and some of the things that you can help, that can help enhance your search results. So in our webinar video gallery, I believe it's going to be on page 3, we actually have one, a webinar called Intro to SEO. So that's an excellent resource as well that you could check out. There's a link there. We also do have our appointment options, where you can actually schedule an appointment with our SEO team and they'll actually go over your website with you and help optimize it a little bit more than it currently is. So that's always another option as well. You can get there, you can, on the training website, there's a link. Also in the support portal, if you click on make an appointment, there's the option for SEO consultation. Gives you a little bit of information on what the appointment actually pertains to and allows you to go through and schedule if you need to. So I'll throw that link in there as well. So, but yeah, I mean, like I said, it sounds like you've gone through and you've done everything in your website that you need to do, such as your phrases and your descriptions and so on. Outside of that, I mean, it's, like I said, SEO is a very complicated process and it's a time-consuming process. And there's a lot of outside factors that can influence influence what we have or what you, how you, your website's showing up. So some of these resources can help kind of get the ball rolling in that aspect for you. All right. Katie says, hi, Alex. I have two questions. I purchased a URL but can't figure out how to set it up so that it points to my website. Katie, first question in the support portal. Let me get back to our support portal. There is an entire section on setting your website live. That's what you need to do. It's a two-step process. It's very simple. There's the chat link in the chat window there. That will take care of that for you. The going live process right here. This is the two-step process on how to point that URL that you purchased to your website. Now, I will tell you that this is one of the questions that comes up the most. Doesn't matter who you purchased your URL from, GoDaddy, Bluehost, whoever. There's literally hundreds of different places you can purchase them from. This two-step process is all you need to do. What throws people off is when you get to step two, where you work with your DNS provider or the person or the company that you purchased your URL from. Every URL has what's called an A record. Everyone, doesn't matter where you buy it from, every website, every web address, every domain has one. The only thing that you need to do to point your domain that you purchased to your website is go into your domain settings and change the A record to point to the live edit servers at this IP address. That is literally all that needs to be done. Once that's done, it'll be a matter of hours and your website's live and good to go. What happens is a lot of times these DNS providers like GoDaddy and stuff, they don't necessarily understand how our system works. So they tell you that you need to have server names and all this other stuff, which is 100% not true. The only thing you have to do is point your A record to our servers using this IP address. That's it. I have a website. I have several websites. I've launched several websites. It's a process that takes less than 10 minutes. So whatever they're telling you, just insist, nope, I just have to point my A record to this IP address. That's it. So once you do that, you're good to go. So that's question number one. Katie's second question is, how do I get my design template to go back to its default settings? Katie, I hate to tell you, but you can't. There isn't any way to go back to the default. You can't wipe, you can't start over. Once you start making changes to it, that's it. There isn't a way, there's not a magic reset button. So one thing that you can do when you're editing your website, and if you've already started and you've already done this, it's a little bit too late, but when you're editing a website, and it doesn't matter which template you're on, if you go to, let me pull up a blank template here. So I'll pull up my Foodie Bonanza template. Now, when I always tell people when you first start editing your site and playing around with colors and so on, what you should do is create what's called a preset. So when you log into your site, in your design tab, down here is our presets. And every template has a preset. It's the look of your template. Now, so there's one listing here automatically. It's the default listing. You can make a new preset by clicking New Preset and giving it a name, So I'm just going to say new preset look, or whatever you want to call it, doesn't matter. And then save that preset. Okay, you'll get a little confirmation message up here that it's been saved. Give the page a quick refresh. Go back into your design tab. Now go down to your presets again and select which one you want. So I'm going to select the one I just created. Do you want to change to that preset? Yes, I do. Get my confirmation message. Now the website's going to refresh, and you can see that everything here is different. The background colors and so on have changed. That's what a preset does. Now I can go through and I can change anything that I want about my website as far as it looks. So anything that I change in my design tab, so any of these style settings that I apply, or anything that I do in the CSS sections on any page, so these little blue notepad icons, anything that I change in there, whenever I save those will be saved to this preset. So let me give you an example. I'm going to add in a background picture for this page. Oh, I need a better picture. It's National Coffee Day, so I'm going to do a search for coffee. There we go. So I like this one. I've used this one before. Place my background picture. Save it. There's my background picture. I'm also going to set some colors for my website to be different, just to mix it up a little bit so you can see that I've made these changes. So I changed the color up here, changed this background color, changed this color down here and down here, okay? So now when I save this change, it's going to save to my preset here, the new preset look that I created. So when I save this, I get a message that's been saved. Great. Can give my page a refresh. There's my website. Looks the way that it looks. Now, if I decide that at some point I don't like this and I kind of want to go back to something else, maybe back to what it looked like when I first started, I can go back to my design tab and I can go to my presets and I can say, well, I want to go back to the default. So I can click default. It's going to ask me if I want to change, and I say, yes, I do. And the website's going to refresh itself and it's back to the default settings. Now, again, this only pertains to these style settings, so your backgrounds and your colors and your font types and stuff. If I went through and I changed all the content, removed these pictures and all that stuff, that's done. Once I change it, there's no way to go back and go back to the beginning. Okay, so if I delete this picture, or if I change this text, or if I delete all this stuff, it's gone. I can't redo it unless I manually go through and retype it again. So the presets only apply to the looks of the website, color schemes, and so on. Now, if you have never created a preset and you've gone through and changed your colors and stuff, there isn't a way for you to go back and start from the beginning. There just isn't. You can still go through and customize things and make more presets, but there isn't a way, an easy way to go back to the beginning. So hopefully that helps with that question for you, Katie. Now, I saw that you have another question. Will you be sending us a recording of this webinar? I'm not sending anybody anything, but the webinar is being recorded, just like they all are. And they are stored in our support portal in the webinar video gallery. The most recent video is always going to be first. This video will be posted by the end of the day. So you can always go back in and rewatch this section if you want to. Now, your follow-up question, another question that a different Katie asked, can you go back to the page with the server number? I didn't get that down fast enough. All this information is in the support portal. In the knowledge base section, the section that I was talking about setting your website live is in the setting your website live section. You can always do a search too in the search bar. If you just do a search for going live, it'll be the first result that shows up. You can click on that and that information will be found down in part two. So, but again, all this stuff is always available in the support portal at any point in time, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. All right. Next question. Maria says, how can I add the link of my new book to my website? Also, how can I make the colors on the rotating pictures of my website look brighter? First question, how do I add the link to my book? Wherever your book is, just make a link to it. A link is there's countless different ways to make a link. It depends on what you want to do. For example, if I want to make this picture a link, I can click on this picture. And in the advanced tab here for this image, there's a section called link. If your book information is located on a different website, you put that link there, the URL, the address of that website. If your book is located somewhere else on your website, you put the address for that page. So it really kind of depends on how you're linking out to your book. Same thing with text. If you want to make text a link, you can type out your text, apply whatever fonts and so on that you want, highlight whatever you'd like to make your text or your link, and click the Insert Edit Link button. And again, add in the address for where you want your link to go, and you're good to go. So, again, if you're stuck, go to the support portal, type in link. You'll see the different options, how to add a PDF link, how to create, there's a video on how to create a link, how to create a button. There's a couple different ways, but the process is all pretty much the same. So, a question came in. Oh, there was a second question for that. Sorry, Maria. The second part of the question, also, how can I make the colors on my rotating pictures of my website look brighter? If you want to make the colors on your pictures look brighter, you're going to have to edit your pictures. You can do that a couple different ways. There's a number of programs that you can get to edit your pictures outside of your website, Photoshop, so on. You also have the ability in your file manager to adjust those pictures. So if you go to your dashboard, go to your file manager, you find a picture that you want to edit, click on that picture, you'll see a preview of it. You go down a little bit and there's an edit button here. You can click that and this opens the photo editor in your file manager. Now this is a really basic photo editor. You can do some things with it, but it's very, very basic. Think of some of the basic photo editors you might have on your phone. This is the same thing. You can go through and you can adjust some things like brightness and so on if you wanted to. You can adjust some of the different settings for colors and so on. So you can edit your picture that way if you wanted. There's also some effects, just like with the apps on your phone. You know, you can do some of those different things. And then once you're done, you save the picture. It'll actually just save a new version. So, for example, let's say I want to make this picture look a little bit different. I can select this. I'm going to apply that. Maybe I want to change the saturation here, make it a little bit more colorful. But I want to adjust the contrast so it's not so... I can do that. Now, if I save my picture, if I click save, I'm going to save a new version of this picture. If I want to undo anything that I've done, I can go down here to the lower left corner, and this is an undo button. So undo that last thing that I did. And the one next to it is a redo. So I can redo that stuff if I want to. And when I save a picture, it's going to save a new version in my file manager. It's not going to do anything to the original one. sometimes it takes a little bit of time. So it'll save it, and then it'll take you back to your file manager, and you'll see your new picture, most likely with the word copy listed on after it, just like this. Sometimes it does that, sometimes it doesn't. You can always tell by the date. You can see your most recent picture. So that's how you can adjust some of those colors if you want to. Otherwise, like I said, I mean, you can do it in any type of photo editing program outside of your website before you update your pictures. Now, once you update a picture like this inside of your file manager, then you have to go to the website and place it. You can't go through and you can't edit a picture that you already have placed on your website. So this picture right here, I can't click on it and edit it from here. I have to edit it in my file manager and then replace it with the new picture on the website. All right, next question. How do I make my site mobile friendly? I know that it helps it come up in searches. I have the heritage package. Is that not available with this package? Your website is what's called a responsive website, meaning that the content on the screen adjusts to fit the screen size. So there isn't a separate mobile version of your website. It's all the same thing. Example, you're seeing my screen here. Now if I shrink my screen down like this, this is the same website, just condensed. This is virtually a representation of what the mobile version looks like. It's no different than the regular version of the website. All it does is kind of condense things down a little bit. As far as how to make it mobile friendly, it's kind of a trial and error type of thing. And you see how you laid out your website and then either shrink your screen down like this or pull up your website on a mobile device to kind of see what it looks like. One of the things to keep in mind, if you go into edit mode, most of the time your content areas are going to display in the order that they are listed. So for example, in section 2 here, anything that I have in content in this box right here will display on the display first on a mobile version, then it'll be followed by this content area, and then this content area, and then this one, and then this one. So it kind of goes from left to right that way and displays in that order. So that's kind of helpful as well. But for the most part, the websites are set up so once you place your content where you want it to be placed, when you're viewing it on a mobile device or a tablet even, the content will be kind of condensed down to reflect the screen size, and most of the time it will display in the way that you intended it to display. So as for the heritage package, that doesn't matter. All of the websites are responsive that way. So it doesn't matter which package or what that you're on. So next question. How do I or can I add a PayPal button to my website? Can I add a page where I can send people to go without going to the main page, like a landing page? You can add a PayPal button for sure. There's actually a guide in the support portal on adding a PayPal button. So it walks you through the process, gives you some of the different options that are available in PayPal to do that, and walks you through the process and how to add that button. It's pretty straightforward. You create your button within your PayPal account. They'll give you what's called an HTML code that you literally just paste onto your website, and it creates your button just like that. So it's pretty simple, pretty straightforward. Makes it really easy. You can place your button on your website. A potential client comes. They want to purchase something. They click on that button. It takes them right to PayPal to complete that purchase. You don't have to worry about anything additional like that. The second question, can I add a page where I can send people to go without going to the main page, like a landing page? You can certainly do that. It depends on how you want to set that up. There's a couple different ways to do that. Without knowing the specifics, one of the things that I would recommend is in the webinar support or webinar video gallery, we did on page 2, you'll see a bunch of videos for this webinar series that we did. We took a website and we built it from scratch. Some of these episodes, like episode 7 and 8, where it talks about landing pages and custom forms and hidden pages, that's going to be relevant to what you're asking about. Can you send people to go to a page like a landing page? That actually is covered in episode 7, 8, and 9. There's different portions of that where we actually go through and set up, I think we set up like 4 landing pages throughout that site. So any one of those episodes will walk you through that process and how you can go ahead and do that. So you might find that to be helpful. And again, like I said, the PayPal stuff, you can go to the support portal, just do a search for PayPal, and you'll pull up that guide rather easily. How much does the SEO appointment cost? I want to say it's $75. Right here, yep. $75 for 30 minutes. Jennifer asks, when you create a new form, how can you change the length of fields so they are not so long? For example, I created a form on my mail page for a webinar sign-up, and the first, last name, and email address fields are so long and go across the page, I cannot figure out how to make them shorter. Thank you. That's a good question. There isn't an easy way to make them shorter, but what you can do is you can adjust which content area you have them in. So let me hop to the contact page here. For those of you that don't understand the question, what Jennifer's saying is she has her form like this, and these fields go across the entire page like that. And the reason that they're doing that, Jennifer, is most likely you have it placed in a content area like this that spans that entire page. If you move your form into a smaller content area, it will be adjusted accordingly like that. That's really the only way to easily make those fields smaller. If you want to have your form have a more narrow look to it to make those fields smaller, you can have some, you can maybe get a form custom created for you. We can go through and apply some styling to it. But really the easiest way would be to kind of adjust where you have the content placed into a small form like that. So the fields are a little bit more user-friendly that way. So that's really the best answer that I have for you. So hopefully that helps. If you have additional questions with that, just let us know. Jennifer also asks, another issue I have is when editing text on my page, if I select certain words to make centered, it will center all of the words on my page. Is there any way around this? I end up just going in and editing the HTML. The easiest way to do that, let me pull up a paragraph of text. So if you want to center a certain portion, like if you have multiple lines of text, so this is a good example here. The way that the website works is when you start adding text, whether you copy and paste it in or type it out, they kind of look at it as one single line of text code. So whenever you apply formatting to it, it applies it to all of it. So if you want to center one line, it'll then center everything. So for example, if I highlight this text and I can see it centered, if I take that off, it moves it everything to the left by default, but it leaves this text alone. And the reason for that is because it's a different line of text code. So to break that up, I'm going to go to this paragraph, which is all one paragraph. To break that up, what you can do, Jennifer, is when you are creating your text, you can actually, let's say I want to make this second, I want to make this 2 sentences. It's kind of hard to see because this is really small, but my first sentence is just going to say, I received my training from the Institute for Integrative Nutrition. So I'm adding a period. And then I'm going to capitalize the W. So I have 2 sentences. Now, if I try to highlight this second sentence, and let's say I want to make it bold, that's fine. But if I want to, you know, move this to the right or center it or something like that, most of the time it's going to affect everything in that sentence. So the easiest way to do that, to kind of break that chain, is to hold down the shift key and hit return. And that essentially breaks that chain. So now that I've done that, I can highlight this text and I can make the size super huge. And I can put it over to the right and I can do whatever I want with it without affecting the other text, because I kind of broke that code. I broke that chain. Hopefully that makes sense for you, Jennifer. You can also do it by going through and editing the HTML. It's kind of the same deal. But the easier way to do that would be just to kind of break that chain. So also, if you want to do different types of formatting on different parts of text, you can also do individual text areas. Like for this section here, if I wanted to, I could just have this sentence be its own text area. Let me just copy that. I can bring in my text area. Let's say I want to paste this in. And I'm going to center it. And I'm going to make it really big and bold. And I can essentially delete it from here. And so on. And it's... they're actually their own separate text areas, but they don't look like it on the page. So I can set them up however I want, and they're individual text areas, but because of the spacing and everything, they look the same. So that's also another alternative. Does kind of make it a little bit easier sometimes to format some of that text differently. So, but hopefully that helps with that question for you. Katie says, thank you for your time and help. You are welcome. Elena says, I just tried to create a new preset, but it says an error. Sometimes if you have an error message like that, it's because you've been logged into your website and you haven't done anything. If you are logged into your website like this and you kind of just sit there and you're watching this webinar and you're not doing anything on your website kind of times out. It's never going to leave you logged in forever. Most websites, whether it's your live in a website or whatever, they don't leave you logged in for security purposes. Your live at a site isn't any different. You have account information in your dashboard that if you left your website wide open, somebody could come into your computer or something and potentially get access to that. So after a period of time, your website does kind of time out. So when you do run into that error message, whether it's trying to create a preset or something, the best way to do is if you refresh your page, most likely you're not going to be logged in anymore. So then you just go through and log in again. Otherwise, you can log out and then just log in again and try it again. So if you do that and then go in and try to create your preset, then you should be able to do that. So when in doubt, just refresh or log in and log out. Usually takes care of the issue. Roseanne says, somehow I have set my page so that when I scroll up, my website rolls behind my heading, which appears translucent. How do I change this so my entire page scrolls upward without my heading remaining at the top? Roseanne, I really don't know. What I think I have an idea, but if you could you paste in or type in your website address into the chat window and I'll take a peek. That will help, I think. So again, if you have questions, please submit them via the Q&A feature and not the chat window. Pam had a question that she submitted via chat. How can I make my font text larger than 36? It's a good question. There's a nice little tip there. Once you highlight your text, and you'll see that 36 is the largest you can go, so you can do that. If you want to make your text larger, after you select 36 or any other font size, you can go into the source code, which is over here on the right-hand side, and you can click and you can find your font size. You don't have to pay attention to anything else. You can find the font size, which is 36, and you can just edit that to whatever you want. So let's say I want this to be 65. I can edit that, click OK, and you'll see the results. So that's how you can do that. It's a nice little trick. You are welcome. All right, so Diana says, well, we're waiting for Roseanne. And again, Roseanne, if you can throw in your chat your website address, that would be fantastic. Oh, she already did. All right, so Diana, I'll get to your question in a minute. I want to tackle Roseanne's question. So let's pull up her website. All right, so this is her website, so I'm going to log in here. All right. Okay, so you're on the Forks and Spoons template. Now, Roseanne, is there a specific page that you're talking about, or are you just talking in general? Because what she's talking about, everyone, is this feature here where her menu is sliding up, or her content is sliding up behind it. And the reason that's happening, that's actually a feature of the template that you picked. It's a feature of the Forks and Spoons template. So if I pull up a normal Forks and Spoons template, like this, you don't necessarily see that because my heading settings right here are white and not translucent. So when I scroll up, everything kind of just fades away. But actually, it's doing the very same thing as your website. If you wanted to change that, what you can do is you can go into your color settings, and if you see your not your menu setting, but you see it should be your headings. But you have these translucent colors. If you changed this color scheme, the color setting for this section up here, which is probably going to be your main content setting, if you change that to a solid color, because you have this colored background, it's really not going to matter if it's translucent or not. If you change this to a solid color, things will still fade up like this, but you won't be able to see them in the background. So the only reason that you're seeing them like that is because the settings that you have for this section are that translucent color. So as far as being able to not keep this heading at the top, again, that's a feature that came with, that's part of the Forks and Spoons template. The only way to remove that would be to change templates, which you probably don't want to do because you've done a really nice job of customizing yours already. What you could do, Roseanne, is maybe submit a ticket to our support team. So in the support portal, if you submit a ticket, fill out the information and ask them if there's a way, if they could possibly turn that feature off for your website. And they might be able to do that. I don't know specifically, but they might be able to. So that would be another option. So, but your website looks nice, by the way. Nice work. So hopefully that helps with your question. All right, so now we got Diana's question. Her question is, I'm not a tech person, so our website is connected to your server, not the domain company where we get the web address. That is correct. Your website, we are what's called your web host. That's why when you order a site, every website has a liveeditaurora.com at the end of the URL. Because when you order a website, it lives on our servers. We are your web host. So everything, your website is stored with us and everything like that. It's built on our platform. Now, the domain name, if you want to buy purchase a custom domain name. You would do that from whoever you wanted to, and that is just a web address that you link to your website, so when people go to your web address, then it takes them to your website. That's how that stuff works. A lot of the companies, GoDaddy and so on, you can also have them be your web host. That does not apply with your Live Edit site. Because your Live Edit site is built on our platform, and that our platform is hosted by us, we will, as long as you have a Live Edit website, we are always going to be your web host. The domain company, the domain DNS provider where you purchase your web address, you're simply just purchasing a web address from them. That's it. So. We had somebody that just joined in, so welcome. I just want to give you a quick heads up. There, you'll see up in your upper left, there is the Q&A feature. If you have a question, submit your question via the Q&A and not via the chat. But since you just joined in, I will just quickly address your question. The question came in via chat. How can I make a pop-up lead on my page? You can't. There isn't a way for you to do that unless you're very skilled at advanced coding yourself. And if you are, then you already know the answer. But for normal, basic, everyday folks like me and you, there isn't an easy way to do that. If you are interested in having a pop-up created for your website, it depends on how you want to do it. Your question was, how can I make a pop-up lead on my page? If you are using a mail service like MailChimp or Constant Contact, you can make a pop-up, I believe, inside your MailChimp account and just take the HTML code and add it to your website, I think. I'm not 100% certain on that. Otherwise, we do have some additional services available. One of those services is a pop-up. It's a very common thing that we can do for you, a pop-up window to do whatever you want. So I will throw this link into the chat window for you. If you're interested in one of those services, just fill out the form on the left. There's no commitment to buy anything or anything, but you can fill out that service, the form, select which one you're interested in, and you'll be sent some more additional information on that. And you can kind of take the ball from there. Diana commented in the chat, for some reason I can't submit questions. I'm seeing your questions in the Q&A feature, Diane. I have your other question that you submitted, the same question about the main thing. We took care of that. So I'm seeing your question submitted multiple times. You don't have to submit it multiple times. I see them. I will get to them in the order that I get to them. I just start from the top of the list and work my way down. So when you submit your question, I'm not going to answer it right away. I will answer as I get to it. But I am definitely seeing your questions. So you're good. All right. So Vicky's question now is there a way to unpublish or hide the recipes page so it doesn't show up on my website? That is a great question. The features that come with your templates, such as the recipe app and stuff, you don't have to use them if you don't want to. So what you can do is you can essentially hide it. It's always going to be available for you. So when you go into your dashboard, you're always going to see the recipe app. It doesn't matter. If you're not using it, that's fine. It's no big deal. But to remove it from your website, because you'll see your little listing here in your menu, just go into the pages section. And if you scroll down to your main menu section, you'll see a tab here that says recipes. If you click on that tab, you'll see some information about it, and you'll see if it's listing, if it's doing anything else. On this example, this is a little bit different than what comes with your template because of some of the different settings that I've applied to it. But if I want to remove this, I can either just delete this tab, or I can just take it and move it into the not in menu section. I move it into the not in menu section and just close out of my pages tab, website will refresh and you don't see it anymore. So Let me pull up a different website. Let me pull up my Forks and Spoons site. And we'll do that same thing because this one's a little bit different. Okay, so for my site here, I don't have my menu showing. Apparently this one isn't going to work very well for me either. Third time's a charm. Let's pull up a different site. I will pull up one of the newer sites. So generally when you get your website, you have your recipes listed under the resources section. Again, it's no different. I can go into my pages section. I can scroll down into my main menu and I see the resources tab. This particular tab has this little icon here, which is kind of hard to see here, but it looks like a family tree. That indicates the dropdown on that page. So if I click on this tab, I can see it's displaying the resources menu. So if I scroll down a little bit further, I see resources menu and my recipes tab. Again, I have the option to delete that tab if I want to, or I can just take and move it to the not in menu section and just close out of my pages section. Website will refresh, and then the resources link will no longer be there. Okay? So hopefully that helps with that question for you, Vicky. Good question, though. Alina says, hi, Alex. How can I make health coaching page my homepage? Alina, I really don't think that's a good idea. You generally don't want to make a different page your homepage. What I would suggest would be to edit your homepage to have the information from your health coaching page displayed on it. If you go into your design tab and you click on your page templates, depending on your template that you have, so my Foodie Bonanza, there's a homepage template. It's different than the rest of the pages on your site. That's why I don't recommend changing a different page to be your homepage. I recommend editing your homepage to have that content on it. That would be my recommendation. So hopefully that helps with that question, but yeah, you have your health coaching page. You can easily just put that same information on your homepage. That's what I would go with. I wouldn't want to change your homepage. So, Lynn asks, is there a Venmo button? There is not. I'm gonna guess that if you have a Venmo account, you can add in the button the same way. I'm gonna guess inside your Venmo account there is a way to add a button. I'm gonna guess it's gonna be very similar to PayPal, but I don't know specifically. Yeah, I'm not really sure. I would check with within Venmo first and see if there is. And if there is, and if it's a little complicated and it doesn't make sense to you, go ahead and submit a ticket to support and ask them. They would have more experience with that than I would. But I've never seen anybody use a Venmo one. I've always seen people use PayPal. But I would guess that it's going to be the same general process. Roseanne says, another question, how do I get my logo to appear in my URL in the search engine? I'm not understanding what you mean. Are you talking about your logo up here? Okay, that's what she's talking about. That is your actual, it's called a favicon. If you go into your, under your profile, and you go under site settings, when you added your logo, right below it is a favicon. You can upload your your file or your whatever here. Generally, it's going to be a square picture. I think dimensions roughly should be about 600 by 600, nothing bigger than that. But you would just add it here. You can also do the same thing in your dashboard. If you click Account Info, there's a tab for Favicon. It's the same thing. You can click Upload, and you can select an image from there. That's how you would do that. One more question. I have centered text on my page of my website, but it does not translate to centered text on my mobile site. Is there a way to correct this? If it's centered, you want to make sure that it's you have it properly centered. If you go into your text area and I say I want this text to be centered, like so, and this text to be centered, like so, that text is centered in that content area. Now, when I shrink the page down to a mobile view like this, that text is still centered in the content area. So as long as you have it centered properly, it should be fine. Which page do you have the text centered on, Roseanne? Since we already had your website, I can actually take a peek here. But which text are you talking about? But yeah, if you want to let me know which text you're talking about that's not showing up on and which page, we can take a peek and I can tell you. But I'm going to guess it's not properly aligned on the page, maybe. I don't know. It really kind of depends. So let me know and I will take a peek. While we're waiting on Roseanne, a question came in. Trying to change text color in the call to action section after we took out the picture on Bonanza, the white text then doesn't show. Call to action area. The call to action area in your color settings, actually this call to action section here is actually pretty worthless on your site. You actually don't have a call to action section. I can change this to whatever I want and it's not going to be reflected on any aspect on any page. So that's, you don't need to worry about that. Some of our other templates for some of our other partnerships actually have a call to action section. Newer templates don't. It's kind of a wasted section. But some of our original ones did, and that's why there's a call to action section in the style settings. For the most part, you can completely 100% ignore that section. It's not going to do anything on your website. So that takes care of that. Now you said, after we took out the picture on Bonanza, the white text then doesn't show. Are you talking about up here? Is that the section that you're talking about? If you remove the background picture, then your white text isn't showing up? Also, if I ask you a question directly, you can also reply via the chat window if that's easier than having to submit a new question. So, I'm not really sure what the question would be about the white text then doesn't show. If I remove this picture in that section and it says the white text doesn't show, it's because it's white. So I'm not really sure what that means. I can click on this and I'm not going to see it in here because it's white. So I need to highlight that and change it to a different color. so I can see it. So maybe that's what you're talking about. But yeah, on your template, this white text is actually, when you're editing it, it's actually white. So you need to highlight your text and change the color so you can actually see it. So hopefully that's what it is. Yep, that's the section. Okay. Yeah, so that's probably what it is. Yeah, it's just the text has actually been set to white in the text window there. So that's why you can't see it. All right, so Roseanne said, it's my story near the bottom. So let's take care of this. My story page down at the bottom. Okay, so this text here, you want this text to be centered on the page. Is that right? The area above this. Okay. Well, first thing is first. When I go into edit mode, it's not going to be centered because your text, well, it should be centered. Let me shrink this down. This kind of goes above or goes with Francis's question. She asks, can you please slowly show me how you go to the mobile cell phone view? I can't slowly show you with the way the screen share works. It doesn't, every time I move my screen, it stops and it kind of pauses the video. All you need to do is if you go down to your, the edges of your browser window, you can see my cursor kind of changes to an arrow. Just click on the side of your window and just drag it smaller. That's all it is. That's all you do. The best thing that I would recommend, if you want to know what your website looks like on a mobile view, pull it up on a mobile phone. This is not 100% accurate right here. So, all right, so we have this content that you're talking about. Okay, so is this kind of what you're talking about, Roseanne? She says, it's the text that reads, it's a lifestyle choice. Let me scroll down here. And there's this text that, and again, this isn't 100% accurate. So if you really want to know what it looks like on a mobile phone, check on your phone. Okay, so this text down here, this is kind of what she's talking about. And the reason that that is happening is because when you go into edit mode and I click on that particular text. Another thing that, another tip that I will give you here, Roseanne, and this is beneficial for everybody. Don't have text areas that are this big. And the reason why is because now if I want to change something, it's going to affect that entire text area. So, if you break this up into individual pieces of text, because you can add multiple pieces of text, it makes it so much easier to edit without having to adjust the rest of this. Now, the reason that your stuff is looking the way it is, if you click, you see where my cursor is right now? There's a big space right here before this text. That's why it's spacing it out. Your text is not centered, you just move spaces. And in when you're viewing the website, it shows those spaces. What you need to do is actually center this text. You see what I'm doing here is you have all this extra space. That space is going to show up. You actually just need to center the text. When you center the text, it'll display properly. And that's what I mean. If you go through and you do this as individual text areas, it's 1,000 times easier to edit than what's going on right now. Okay, so here's this paragraph here. I want to put this text on its own like that. So I'm going to highlight this text and then I'm going to center it. Same thing with this text. I'm going to highlight this text and I'm going to center it. And we're running into issues because there's a lot of stuff going on with this big, large text area. That's causing some issues. So that's centered. Now that's centered. So now if I hit space and do this, it's all centered. Now I'm going to go ahead and save these changes. And I'm going to refresh your page. And it's centered. So now when I look at it on a different device, like the mobile device, I scroll down, and that text is centered. So boils down to a lot of it is not set up properly. It's not centered properly. So what I would highly suggest for you, Roseanne, is to go through and adjust that text that way, just kind of like what we did, but break it up into individual pieces if you can. It's not difficult. It's just going to be a little bit more time consuming to do that. But you definitely want to do that. I highly recommend it. And I'll show you quickly how to do that. So what I'm going to do is I will take this last paragraph here, this "Do you love credentials and stuff?" I'm going to take that and make it its own text area. Okay. So because you have one big long text area, what I'm going to do is I'm going to click on edit, and I'm just going to go to the source code, and I'm going to highlight and copy everything in it. And then I can cancel out of this and close this window. Now I'm going to bring a new text area and place it right here. And I'm going to go to that source code button again, and I'm going to paste everything in there. So I essentially made a duplicate copy. Now I want to just save the last paragraph. So I'm going to take everything else and delete it. So it's just this last paragraph. Now I click save. Now I have that last paragraph like that. Now I can go through and I can adjust this paragraph and not have it affect anything else. If I want this to be centered, perfect, done. If I want it to be right aligned, I can do that. So that's how you can go through and break up these pieces into individual text areas. You can place the picture, it's by itself. You don't have to place it within your text area. You can just take the image tool and plop it in there and select your picture. So you're gonna have a much better result going that route. So hopefully that helps with that question there. As long as I'm sitting here, you had another question. Is there a time limit on when I will be able to edit my page? Also, when does my free live edit account end? You can edit your page whenever you want. There isn't a time limit. Like I said, it times out if you don't do anything, but you'll notice that it won't let you edit anything. You'll get an error message. Just refresh your page and log in. But otherwise, you can edit your page whenever you want. As far as your free trial, if you go into your dashboard, click on your account info, tells you when your free trial is going to expire. And you should start getting email notifications about a month prior to remind you. So, hopefully that helps with your questions. And again, like I said, I recommend that for anybody else. When you are adding text to your website, that's great. Do that. But don't use one big, huge content area. You don't have to. You can use as many as you want, and it just makes things so much easier to edit going forward. So, good lesson in that. All right, Shirley says, I set up the blog feature, but it is appearing at the bottom of my homepage as well as on the blog page. How do I change that? Shirley, you probably have what's called the blog feed right here. If you go into edit mode and you click on that section on your homepage, you see this little tab that says blog. That just means that you are using the blog element, which just displays blog posts. If you don't want to use it, click on it. There's a little delete button down here. You can click on it and delete it, and it's gone. If you want to add it back, just take the blog tool, pop it there, say I want it to display the two most recent blog posts. I can go into my advanced tab and say I want it to show, you know, all the content or whatever, and save your changes, and it'll come right back. So hopefully that helps with your question. How do I change the PDF form that is embedded in the lead generation window? Like if I want to add a freebie of mine other than that form. You can't. That form is using the IAN lead generation form that cannot be edited. You only get the choice of the cleanse cheat sheets with that. If you want to do your own giveaway, you have to create your own custom form. And you're in luck because in our support portal, if you do a search for form, you will see a number of options there. But if you do a search for lead generation, you will see a listing come up, say how to create a custom form. This is a video walkthrough of how to go ahead and create your own custom form to do any type of giveaway whatsoever. So if you don't want to use the IAN lead generation form, you can use a custom one instead. So, like I said, this video will walk you through the entire process. Shirley has a follow-up, says, no, it's not. It is showing on the homepage. Can I make it show only on the blog page? If it's showing on the homepage, Shirley, it's using that blog listing. It's the only possible way it's showing. There isn't any other way that your blog is showing up there. Just go into edit mode, click on those blog listings like that, and then click delete. The blog tool is on your website by default with your templates, most likely. So that should take care of it. If that isn't helping, let me know, but that should take care of it. In the templates, there's the blog tool, the blog element is popped on there as an example. You just click on it, it'll look just like this. Just click delete, and then it'll be gone. And then your blog post will always show on your blog page. That's just a little shortcut. It lets you throw some previews out there for people if you want. So if you don't want to use it, you don't have to. Susan says, how do you add, I think it's called a hyperlink, where it would say, for example, for a free consult, click here, instead of showing the link to click. It's just text. I'm not really sure what you mean. If you want to have text that says for a free consult to click here, you just type in the text for a free consult, click here, and then make it a link. Or are you talking about like a button? Again, you don't have to submit your questions multiple times. I have them, I see them, and I will get to them. So submit it once and then you're good. I see everybody's questions. I keep track of them. So you don't have to keep sending them over and over again. So, but yeah, Susan, it depends if you want to do a text link or a button. Either way, the process is the same. You just create your link and do it that way. Okay, so she says yes, like a button. It's just a matter of creating a link. There's actually a guide on how to create a button. I did a video on it not that long ago. I'll throw this link in the chat window there for you. But it's pretty basic. You just go ahead and you create a link. And then when you're creating a link, you can make it a button. So I'll just use this paragraph as an example. You type out your text that you want, and if you wanted to make it a link, you would highlight the text, and then you would go up and click on your Insert Edit Link icon here. add in the destination for your link, and then to create a button, you actually go down to the class section here and select which button you want to use. When you click OK, and you save your change. I need to set my link first. So I want it to go there. There's my button. And my button looks the way that it looks because that's what I have set up in my colors section. Your colors section is your button section here. So, but again, that video will walk you through, you know, the same steps. So that should help. Lynn says, when I put in my info to get the cleanse cheat sheet to see what it is, it downloads a PDF called junk. Should I open this? It's the junk food cleanse cheat sheet. There's three cheat sheets. There's a junk food cleanse, a sugar cleanse, and a veg plunge. Go into your dashboard to adjust the settings for which form you want to use. And like you said, you're doing the great thing. The right thing is fill out the form yourself to get copies of those. But yeah, the junk food one, it's called junk, but it's the junk food cleanse. So you're fine. As far as the changing the name of the file, once you download it, yeah, you can change it. But other than that, no, you can't. I also don't know, question came in, also don't know how to create an event that shows on the calendar. Basically, what is the purpose of the calendar? The calendar is literally just a calendar. It shows any events that you have upcoming or anything like that. It's not a scheduling tool or anything like that. It's just a calendar. So if you go to a lot of workshops, or if you have a lot of speaking engagements that people are going might want to be attending or something like that, you can put that information on your calendar. You can provide links so people can sign up for those types of things or attend them or whatever you want it to do. But that's generally the purpose of it. It's not a scheduling tool whatsoever. As far as how to do anything with it, I'm gonna say this a lot, and you're gonna see me coming here a lot, and I'm gonna push this stuff. Because we have a support portal for these things. You can do a search, calendar. Calendar service gives you an overview on how to go ahead and set up all of the different things, how to add events, how to modify events, so on and so forth. So there's a section on that. I don't think there's a video on it. But yeah, it's pretty basic. There's a couple different guides on how to do categories and so on, but for the most part, that's pretty much it. I think this first guide here would be the most helpful one for that question. Diana asks, can you go over what is covered in the Manage Your Aliases tab functions? That's in the going live process. I'm not going to cover it because there's a lot of stuff already on it. The going live process, the managing alias tab, right here, this is step one, walks you through everything you need to know. There's also a video that walks you through the exact same process. In a nutshell, when you set your website live, you go to your Manage Your Alias tab and you add in the URL that you want to use. So if you purchased, you know, dianaswebsite.com, that's where you go in and add this in. This is where you link that to your website. So, but the guides in the video in the support portal will 100% walk you through exactly what you need to do with that and how you need to set it up. Pamela says, is there somewhere I can go that someone can walk me through all of this, because I can't even get started because I don't know how to set up a website. Every time I try to do something, everything gets more messed up. Well, there's a couple different options here for you, Pamela. The first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to recommend two things. First, I'm going to put this link in the chat window for you. Uh, this is the first video that I think you should watch. This is the basics. It helps you pick your website, which you already have your template, so that's good. But it helps you get set it up with the basic things and kind of figure out what you're going to do with your website. So it's seriously starting at the beginning. And then if you go through some of the other things, such as, you know, episode 2 and so on, you can find those helpful as well. Even back to these first pages, this most recent series that we just did, all we did is every week I took a different page of a website and changed the way it looked. I didn't add any content to it. I didn't delete any. Well, I deleted a few things, but I didn't really do anything other than change the way it looks. So that's a good example of seeing how that stuff gets done. Another great resource for you is our training website. And on that training website is a Getting Started checklist. And I'll put this link in the chat window as well. This is a nice little checklist that Ian came up with, and I helped him with it, that just lists a couple of steps just to go through and little by little set up your website. It can be a little frustrating, a little overwhelming. This checklist is a great tool to get started because you can just do a couple things at a time and kind of just take it easy. Set some goals and say, today I'm going to do the first 4 things, and tomorrow I'm going to do the next 3 things and stuff like that, and just kind of work your way through it. And you'll be surprised by the time you get halfway through it, you're going to start feeling a lot more comfortable with how to actually do stuff with your website. I'm really confident that if you make your way through the entire list, you're going to feel pretty confident that you can do this by the time you're done. So there's that aspect as well. Also, we do have our appointments that can be helpful for you. You can schedule a design appointment if you wanted to. You can actually sit down and work with one of our designers to get some ideas on what you can do with the site. You can do a support appointment. A support appointment is kind of like a mini webinar where you get to have some one-on-one time with a member of our support team and ask them questions on how to do different things. So that could be helpful as well. And then again, we have some of our services where we can actually do things for you. We can set up your homepage. We can build your whole site if you want to, but we can do some of those things for you and kind of help take that burden off of you as well. So I'll put that in the chat window as well if you want. But those are some excellent resources for you to kind of get started with it. Roseanne's question, is there a particular package that allows all that I can do with my website right now? I don't understand the question. I'm not sure what you mean by that. So if you could clarify, that would be fantastic. Irene asks, how can I upgrade my subscription? You can go to this page, and I'll put this link in the chat window as well. You can see the different packages that we offer and the features of each one. And when you are ready, once you've decided on which one you want, just click Submit Request, fill out the form, and follow the instructions. And that will upgrade your package. Generally, it takes a day or two for the process to be completed, but that is where you would go through and do that. Susan says, thank you. You are welcome. Roseanne says, can I add a new cheat sheet or link to that homepage button? No, that's the custom lead generation form. So that's the custom lead generation form video that I threw out in the chat window. In the support portal, you can actually do a search, or you can scroll down to the app section where we have our forms, and you'll see that how to create a form for custom lead generation offer. So, Question, which package equates to the free package from IAN? When you're looking at the packages, it says starter. That's the free trial. That's, you know, everybody's on the starter package when they get their free trial. So. Question, where did you get the calendar guide, please? In the support portal. The support portal is accessed at iansupport.getliveedit.com. Every one of you can get to your support portal and get to the support portal in the easiest fashion by logging into your website. So if you're on your website, you're logged in, scroll to the profile, click help. It takes you right there. Bookmark this page. I promise you, you're going to use it a lot. But you can come here and you can do a search for various topics. If you click on the knowledge base section, that'll get you to this section here where you can scroll through and see all the different guides and so on that we have. And at any point in time, if there's things that you're not seeing there or things that you would like to see, by all means, let us know. You know, we're more than happy to build out more guides, more videos, whatever's going to help you guys with your websites is what we want to give for you. So, but take advantage of the support portal. There's a lot of really good information there for you. Diane says, are we allowed to use the free images that are included in the website for our brochure and other marketing materials? That's a great question, and the answer is yes, you can. The free images that are included with your website that are in your file manager, as well as any of the images that you use via the media element, they are free to use images, so you can use them for whatever you want to use them for. There's also a guide in the support portal, and we've talked about this in a lot of our webinars. There is a guide. It's called Resources for Finding Stock Images. This is a list of websites where you can get free images to use for whatever you want. If you want to use them for your website or brochures or other marketing, whatever, you can 100% do that. A lot of these images, you'll see a lot of the same images, but I use these websites all the time. So, Katie asks, can we change the page name within the menu? I tried to change Work With Me to My Services. It wouldn't take effect, but maybe it's my slow connection. You would do that by going into your pages section. If you want to change My Resources, so let me put this background image back because this is annoying me. Really? Okay, so Katie's question is how to change these listings. So you would go into your pages menu, and in your main menu section will show all the tabs for all the listings in that section. If you want to change the name of any of them, just click on the tab, and the information about that tab will appear on the right-hand side. So if it's a page, and a page is indicated by these little page icons here, you can change the name. You should probably take care of the SEO title at some point, but then you also want to change the URL as well. So if you change your page name to something else, you can certainly do that. Now, in Katie's question, she's tried to change Work With Me to My Services. It wouldn't take effect. The Work With Me tab here happens to be a drop-down, so I would just click on it, and I can just say My Resources. I'm going to spell that correctly. And then click Update. The button actually doesn't do anything. Like, it doesn't highlight, which it should, and you won't see the change happen immediately. What you need to do is click Update and then close out of your Pages section, and you'll see your website will refresh itself, and then that change will go into effect. So, anytime you make any change like that in the Pages section, you actually won't see the change physically until you close out of Pages and then go back into it. So, hopefully that helps with that question for you, Katie. Roseanne says, can you quickly repeat the answer to my button question on the homepage? Where do I find that information again? Refresh my memory, Roseanne. What was your button question on the homepage? You mean the question, can I add a new cheat sheet or link to that homepage button? This one here, is this what you're talking about? You can't change this form. This form that is on your website here cannot be changed. It's the IAN lead generation form. It's not editable. If you go into edit mode and you click on it, you'll see this window. You cannot change anything about it. If you want to change which cheat sheet is associated with that, you go into your dashboard, select the IAN Forms application, select the lead generation form. In the download portion, you can select between the cheat sheet options. Select whichever one you want, save your change. Now, if you want to give away something else, do your own, you're going to have to create your own form to do that. And in the support portal, under the forms section, there is a video on how to do that, how to create your own form to set up your own giveaway. So that is going to answer that question for you. So this video here, you can easily find it by going to the portal and just doing a search for lead generation. It's going to be one of the top search results that you're going to find. So, but that'll walk you through how to create the form, how to set it up, and all that stuff. So that will answer that question for you. You are welcome. And again, I don't want to sound like a broken record, but the support portal is really an excellent resource. I'm a little bit biased. All the videos, I did 90% of them. Every webinar that I've done is in there. I've made most of the guide pages that are in there, or I've supervised making them. So I tried to make them as user-friendly as possible, and try to give you guys as much helpful information as possible. So definitely go there, take a look. You know, I think you're going to be able to find a lot of the answers to your questions there. And again, it's not perfect by any means. So if you go there and you're not finding your answers, or if things aren't very clear, let us know. Excuse me. Let us know. You know, submit a ticket to us. Let us know, and so on. So we can make this stuff better. Roseanne says, will I always have access to this? Yes. As long as you have a live edit site, you have access to the support portal. So, Sam goes with Diane's question. I understand we have 6 months after graduation to activate our website. During those 6 months, do we still have access to these tutorial videos? Everything in the support portal is available for you as long as you have a website. So from the day you start, and the day you sign up and pick your template, you have access to this. And you will always have access to it. So there's no way, it's our support portal. There's no way we can restrict access to it. So you can come here. That's what I mean. Bookmark the web address. You can go there as little or as often as you want to. So absolutely. You can use it as much as you want, anytime. I think that I got to everyone's question. Diana had a follow-up. Even if we don't activate our website. Yeah, it's just a website. So literally anybody can go to iansupport.getliveedit.com. Doesn't matter if they have a website or not. It's not going to make any sense to them if they don't have a live edit website, but if you haven't activated your trial yet and you kind of just want to see how things work, by all means, you can come here and watch some of the webinar videos and so on, and just get an idea of how things work. Absolutely. So, you are welcome. I think that I got to all of the questions that were submitted. So, if I missed any questions or if you want any follow-ups or anything like that, by all means, fire away and let me know. When we do these Q&As, I generally don't set a time frame. I'm perfectly fine answering questions as long as you all have questions to ask. So, Pam says, you are always so very helpful. Thank you. You are welcome. I'm glad that these are helpful for you. That's the purpose of it. My sole job with Live Edit is client education and training. So my job is to make you all feel comfortable with editing your website. So it's nice to know that these are helpful for you. We generally do the webinars every week. Most of the time they have a topic that we cover, but we always do a Q&A like this at the end of the session. This week was a little bit different because we didn't really have much of a topic, so we just decided to do a normal one. I think next week and the week after, maybe next week for sure, we're going to take a break. We're not going to do a webinar. Kind of take a little break, kind of recoup a little bit and come up and brainstorm on what we're going to do next as far as topics and stuff. So, Irene has a question. Last question is about how to upload videos on the website. You can upload videos just like you would with an image. You can do so in your file manager. You can upload a video the same way. I generally don't recommend it. If you want a video on your website, the best course of action is to do like a YouTube video or something. There is also, when you're on a page of your website, when you go into edit mode, you'll see a video tool. It works very much like the image tool. You drag and place it on your page, and it's going to ask you to select the video that you've uploaded to your file manager. Like I said, it works okay. I would highly recommend doing something like a YouTube video first or instead. With the YouTube video, you literally just drag it and then you add in the URL of your YouTube video. So, for example, let me pull up our... I'll close some of these extra tabs here. Let me pull up our Live Edit YouTube channel. Here's last week's webinar video. If I want to add that to my website, I can, just like I did, drag the YouTube element, place it on the page. All I have to do is take this URL and copy it, paste it into this lovely box here, click save. And there's my video. It plays nice and smooth. I mean, that's what YouTube does. They're a video streaming service, so they're fantastically awesome that way. So you're going to get better playback that way. It's going to be a better experience for your users and so on. So yeah, that's what I would highly recommend versus uploading videos. So hopefully that helps with that question for you, Irene. You are welcome. Roseanne says, can you explain how to insert scrolling images? Do you mean like how this text is rotating? How to do that with images? Is that what you're talking about? Okay, so she says, yes. That's actually what's called an HTML slider. If I go into edit mode and I click on this, you can see that this is the HTML slider. It says right here, this white tab will always tell you which tool was used to create that. So the HTML slider, which is this tool right over here. Essentially, all it is, it's multiple text areas. Each slide, you'll see it looks just like a text area. That's it. That's all they are. So if I wanted to do one with images, I'm going to take my HTML slider. I'm going to place it here. And if I want to add a slide, I click the Add Slide button. I can add as many slides as I want. If I want to delete a slide, I just click the trash can icon down here. And I'm going to get this notification saying, do you sure you want to delete this slide? And I say, yep. Now, again, this is the same exact interface if I was going to add text. And with that interface, I do have the option to insert an image. So I can select that. In the source section here, if I click on this folder, that'll actually take me to my file manager where I can select my picture. You're going to want to make sure that the picture you're using is the appropriate size. You don't want to do super huge pictures because they're not going to look very good. And the important thing is when you add multiple pictures to slides, they have to be the same size. So you're going to probably have to do some editing. If you have images that are different sizes, when they transition from one to the other, it's going to look really bad. It's not going to look good at all. So you want to make sure that you have them seamlessly transitioning from one slide to another by having the images be the same size. That's very important. So I'm just going to pick an example. So I'm going to take this picture and I don't want it to be this size. So I'm going to click on this and I can select from this kind of generic list of sizes, or I can create my own size. And I can create a size by entering in my width. Now, as long as I don't go bigger than the original, I'm good. So let's say I want to do 650. So I type in my width, click that blue arrow. There's my new size. Click accept. Click OK. There's my picture. Okay. Now on slide 2, I would do that same thing. Select insert image, click my picture. I'm just going to use the same picture because I just want to. Actually, let's see if I can find something else. I'll try this one. Here's the picture that I want to use for slide 2. If I go and enter my 650 again, I can click accept, click OK. Now you're going to see that they're different sizes. If I click on this picture and I click on this insert edit image button, which does the same thing as this, by the way, I can see that this picture is 650 by 487. If I go to slide 1 and I select on this picture, I can see that this picture is 650 by 221. So they're different sizes. I'm going to get rid of this slide for now. So I have these two slides with two different pictures. If I save this, and I'm just going to refresh my page, I see my slider with my picture. Now, when they transition, they're different sizes. So as you can see, it doesn't look very good. That's why you want them to make sure that they're the same size. If you have pictures that are the same size, they will play back much nicer. And with this picture, because it's smaller, I can't make it any bigger. If I make it bigger, the picture is going to look terrible. So my best course of action is, if I want to use this picture, would be to make this picture smaller. And I can do that, like we talked about before, by going into my file manager, finding that picture, and editing it. So if I edit this picture, first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to resize it. If I click resize, I already know that I want my picture to be 650 pixels wide. So I can type in 650 pixels. It's going to automatically adjust my height accordingly. I can click apply. Now, I know that my other picture is 650 by 221. And that's the size that I want because I want to use that strawberry, raspberry background or whatever. So now I can crop this picture to fit that same size. So if I go to crop, I can enter my width of 650, like that. And I can see that that's the width of my picture, so I'm good to go. Now I want it to be 221 pixels high. So I do that, and then I see a selected area of this picture that's highlighted. this is the dimensions of that picture. So I can actually move this to choose which part of the picture I want to use. Because of the nature of this picture, I'm going to stick with the main subject. So I'm going to keep it there and click apply. So now I've set my picture. If I click on resize here, I can see it's 650 by 221. It's perfectly fine. That's what I want. Click apply, click save. Just like we talked about before, it's going to save a new version of that picture. So if I scroll through my file manager, I will see a new picture. The naming isn't the same, but I can see the time. This is the one that I just did. So generally what I do, just to keep things a little bit more organized, is I will click on this, and you can change the name. So I would say coffee edit, or something to that effect, and then scroll down to the bottom and click save. So that helps me keep track of my pictures, so I know the differences. So there's the original one, there's the one I just changed. So now if I go back to my home page, I can go back into edit mode, click on my slider. I like this one. This one I want to change, so I'm going to actually select this picture, and I can go and click on this folder again, and I can choose a different picture. So I'm actually going to choose the one that I just made. Excuse me. I know that the settings are, the size is good, so I can just click accept. Click OK. Gives me my new picture, which is the same size as this picture. Save my change. Refresh my site. Now I can see that when it transitions, it's a nice, seamless transition. Now there's other things that you can adjust with that, with the settings and so on, but yeah, that will take care of it for you. So I mean, it's really important to get that those images to be the same size, whatever size you want to use. So that's kind of an overview of how the HTML slider works. And the same thing, you can do it obviously with text, just like this one. Doesn't matter. You can do text with images if you want. There's a lot of different possibilities there. So Katie asks, if you change the name of the picture that is already placed on the site, do you have to place it again, or does it automatically take effect? It should automatically take effect. So if you edit your, if you change the name in your file manager and that picture is already placed, it should be fine. It should change it for you. So you shouldn't have to worry about it too much. Ronan says, fascinating how much I can do with this site that I didn't know about. There is a lot that you can do with the websites. So, can you include text that slides with the picture? Yep, you can. It's no different. Like I said, you can go into, when you're creating your slides, I can add text below this picture if I want to. Like so. And again, you just want to make sure that your slides are consistent. So if I add text there and I want to do the same thing on this one, I would want to make sure that spacing is the same in order to do that. Follow-up was, I mean, written in the picture. No. The only way you can do that is if you can edit the picture yourself and include the text on it. You can't do that within the website. So. Julie says, can we send you emails with specific questions? Unfortunately, no, you can't. If we did that, I would never get anything else done. So that's why we do the webinars. It gives you the opportunity to ask questions. But otherwise, if you have questions, you can 100% submit your question as a ticket in the support portal. Our support team is fantastic. They do a great job of answering questions, just like I do. So it's a great resource there that you can do. But like I said, a lot of the support, a lot of the guides and so on in the support portal are there to answer those questions. So my suggestion would be check the portal first. If you're not finding your answer, submit a ticket. And we will get that answer for you. Diane says, there's a lot of info to absorb. Can you go over if the website has color enhancements on photos, lighting, editing food photos after they're uploaded? You can edit pictures in your file manager, just like I just did. That's the only option you have. We covered this before a little bit earlier. You can edit a picture, and there are some options for color and so on, but it's not a professional photo editor by any means. So if you really want to edit your pictures and make them look nice, you know, maybe you want to invest in a photo editing program. So Anonymous says, perfect, can you give me the link to that? What do you want the link to? Oh, the support portal. It's always going to be iansupport.getliveedit.com. That's how you get there all the time. Like that. You can also get there when you're logged into your site. Just go to your profile, click help. Opens a new window, takes you right there. You always have access to it. Any other questions, comments, concerns? Dana, another question that you were asking about the photos. There is actually a webinar that we did that you can find in the webinar video gallery, I believe on page 3. It's called Everything You Need to Know About Photos. We talk about all the different ways you can place images and so on, and how to import them, how to edit them within the site. So we go into a little bit more in-depth with what you can do editing-wise in the file manager. You might find that helpful specifically. So just FYI, you might want to check that out a little bit if you want to. I think that takes care of all the questions that have been submitted so far. So again, if we have any additional questions, fire away. Diana comments, the photo editing area that I just opened up was what I was searching for. Yep, that's in a file manager. You can actually do a search for file manager. You can even do a search for photo editor, and that'll show up as well. So there's an actual guide that kind of covers the same deal. Like I said, it's a pretty basic photo editing program. There's nothing super fantastically awesome about it. I'll put that in the chat window too. That might help. But it's enough to get the job done depending on what you want it to do. So it's great for resizing pictures and stuff. It's okay for editing colors and so on. Any other questions or comments? Like I said, the video for today's session will be available later on in the portal. The only downside to the videos for the Q&As are, because they cover so many different topics, they're kind of difficult to watch. Unless you sit down and watch the entire thing. It's kind of hard to scroll through them and find the specific spot that you're looking for. So generally when we do our topical webinars, we don't actually record and post the Q&A portion just because they kind of go all over the place. So question came in, how do I join the basic? What do you mean how to join the basic? like sign up for the basic package? Oh, if you want to upgrade your website, you can go to you can go to this link, and I'll put that in the chat window as well. You just go to that link. You can see the different packages that are available, and then just click submit request and follow the instructions to upgrade. So. It usually takes a couple days for your upgrade to take effect, so you want to make sure to do it before your trial expires. But you don't need to do it like a week or a month or anything beforehand. Just a couple days probably will work. So, Roseanne says, "Can I insert YouTube videos of interest to my site, or does that interfere with copyright?" It should be okay. What I always recommend for people is if you are concerned, contact the owner of the video and ask them. It shouldn't be a big deal. Most of the time, I don't think it's an issue, especially if they post it on YouTube. YouTube is there for you to be able to share the video. I mean, that's one of the major features of YouTube. So for the most part, I think it should be fine. But when in doubt, you can always check. Diana says, the creating ticket option, is that used just to subject basic questions? It's for any question that you want to have, whether it's basic or not basic. I mean, that's how you submit your question. So whatever your question is, that's how you go about submitting it. Question came in the chat. How can I change the logo I have posted on my website? Two ways. If you already have a logo, you can go into edit mode and click on the default section up here, and then either select a new logo or upload a new logo if you want. You can also do the same thing under your profile by clicking site settings and adding your logo here or changing your logo here. So those are the two ways to do it. Roseanne says, is there a charge for creating ticket questions? There is not. But you have a certain number of tickets allotted to you based on your package. So if you're still on the starter period, you get 2 tickets per month that you can submit. So when you go through and submit that ticket, if you've exceeded your amount of tickets, they will let you know. You'll get a notification telling you that. But otherwise, you have 2 tickets a month that you can submit. So, not a bad deal. The other packages have more tickets that you can get. So, if you want to do that, that's fine. But if you exceed your amount of tickets per month, you will be asked if you want to schedule a support appointment. Like I said, support appointments are little mini webinars. I think they cost $20 for 20 minutes. You can ask whatever questions you want, and whoever you work with on the support team will be able to show you stuff just like I do with the webinars. So like I said, they're basically little mini webinars. Okay, he says, I'm in the process of getting a logo created. I've used the Forks template. I wonder if a horizontal logo would be better since the header size at the top changes as you scroll. What are your thoughts? In most of the time, and let me pull up a Forks and Spoons. Most of the time, a horizontal logo is going to be your best bet just because that's the way that it works. As far as what you have here, that'll actually, because when you scroll up, this actually shrinks, your logo will condense down appropriately, even if you have a square logo there. We looked at it with Roseanne's site too. It was kind of the same deal where her logo got a little bit smaller, but it didn't like distort it or anything. So if you want to do a horizontal logo, that's totally fine. In my personal opinion, especially with this site, or even any of the other sites, really, I like having a smaller top heading area there personally. So I would go with a horizontal, more of a horizontal logo. But if you were, if you joined into our last series that we just did, I added this logo. This is a square logo. So, but I also had the ability to add in some stuff over off to the right as well. So it's really kind of a personal preference. But if you're getting the logo created, you might want to think about possibly getting both, if that's an option. So it never hurts to have more than one option. Annalena says, I made a series of videos in a YouTube channel that I also made. How do I make them come together in the channel? I copied and pasted the link of the channel, but it did not work. Also, they are all of the pages. How do I put them in just the front page? I'm not sure what you mean by how do you make them all come together in the channel. I don't really understand what you mean by that. Like on the webs on your website. Okay. Do you mean you want to have each of the videos displaying so people can watch them on the website, or do you want them to go to your YouTube channel to watch it? And you also said, you have commented, they're also in all of the pages. If you can, okay. If you can, Annalena, can you put your website URL in the chat window and we'll actually just pull up your site and take a peek. That might help me get a better idea of what it is you're actually looking to do. I think I have an idea. But if we can actually take a peek at your website, I think that might help. Thank you very much. All right, let's pull up her website and take a peek here. Okay. Okay, so you have all of your videos down here like this. All right, so let's see what we got going on here. Okay, so you, this is what I was wondering. Okay, so you went through and you posted, you did each video individually like that. Okay, that's perfect. I would have done the same thing. Okay, now, one of the things that I will tell you, see, you put it in the footer section here. The footer section here has this little circular icon, which is different than these. This means it's a global area. That means it appears on every single page of your website. So if you don't want something to appear on that page, on every page, then you simply move it out of that section. It's also very easy to inadvertently move things. So like here's your blog section, and this is the blog element. This is the example that came with your website. It was very easy for you to inadvertently move it out of this section. So you can actually just move it back. And now it's no longer going to appear on every page. So the same thing I would recommend doing with your YouTube videos. You want to put them in different sections. Now, because of the way that you have it laid out, I would suggest doing this. Putting your blog up here. Like so. And then we have two columns here. Main area 3 or sidebar 3. And you could put your videos there. And you could alternate them if you wanted to. so. So you can just kind of alter the layout. Another thing that you can do, when you place a video like this, you can click on it, and if you go into the advanced settings, you can determine, and I think that you've adjusted some of this, you can adjust how much of that section you want it to show. So if you have these videos, if you want them to be centered, you have that centered there. That kind of works a little bit. You want your width to say, it'd be 75. And you can click that, and it's going to adjust it that way. Sometimes the centering thing doesn't necessarily work the way it's supposed to. With the YouTube videos, I generally just leave it at the inherent. Sometimes when you try to adjust it, the alignment to right or left, it just kind of screws up the way the video displays. So that would be one option that you could do. Same thing with something like this. Adjust your width accordingly like that. So there's different ways that you can lay that stuff out using the different content areas. Another excellent way is in columns like this, where there's three of them. You know, put a video here, put a video there, and so on. So does that kind of make sense for you? That should help with your question. I can also see that you have a huge blank space here in your footer. Looks like that was another video too. So I don't know why that one's not displaying. So I don't know. Yeah, I don't know why it's not displaying. There might be an issue with that URL. Okay, so let's see. Because this is being goofy, the easiest thing to do is just delete it completely. It's very easy to add it back, so just delete it and try adding it again. Sometimes you can take this URL, but you can also go down here to share and copy this one as well. It's the same thing, doesn't matter. But sometimes if you're running into issues, that might be a solution, like that. So, but it looks like the video was up here too. So, but that's the nice thing about things like the YouTube video. They're super easy to delete and just replace if you're running into issues. So, but hopefully that helps with that question for you. you are welcome. Diana says, on Roseanne's Forks and Spoons website, what was fixed again on the header section that she couldn't change? What's the difference in the two? The issue that she was talking about with the Forks and Spoons template is when you scroll down that your heading, your menu, your listings up here stays there like this. When you scroll, it stays there. That's the only template that it does it on. It doesn't do it on any of the other ones. That's what she was talking about. So, as for the difference in the two templates between Forks and Spoons and Saver, Saver and Organic and Health Coach Pro are newer templates. They have some different content area layouts. That's pretty much it. There's not a whole lot of differences other than that. Virtually everything you can do with Forks and Spoons, you can do with Saver. So there's really no huge difference between the two. Any other comments, questions, anything like that? Yeah, Diana says, okay, so the new ones don't have that fixed area. Nope, they don't. The only one that does is Forks and Spoons. We didn't put it on any of the new templates. It's not the most popular feature in the world, so we didn't include it in the new templates.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think that if we don't have any other questions, I think we can wrap it up for this week. I said the video for today's session will be available later in the support portal later this afternoon. So you can always go back in and rewatch it. Because of the kind of nature of the Q&A, just keep in mind it's going to be a little bit difficult to kind of scroll through and find specific things. But if you missed any of the answers that we had or anything like that, you can always go back in and rewatch it. So, Roseanne says, once a template is chosen, it is a final choice, correct? No, you can change your template whenever you want. Just a little word of warning. Anytime you change a template, you're going to have to make some adjustments. You pick a template, your website is set up with that template. If you change to a different one, your website's going to change a little bit. So you're going to have to go through and make that adjustment. Now, if you're changing from one of the original templates, which is Forks and Spoons, Foodie Bonanza, and Zest, to one of the newer templates, which again is Savor, Organic, or Health Coach Pro, you will run into problems. Same thing if you're changing from one of the new ones to the old ones. You're going to run into some problems. There's some compatibility issues with the templates from changing from an old one to a new one. So if you want to do something like that, I suggest submitting a ticket to support and saying, hi, I'd like to change my template from whatever it is to whatever it is. Can you help? They will send you the instructions on how to do that. It's going to be very manual and it's kind of a pain. I'll show you what I mean. On this template, on this site, I have forks and spoons. If I go to my design and select Savor and apply that design, this is what happens. All of my sample content is gone and I need to start over. So again, there's some compatibility issues with the new templates, so you're going to run into this, and that means you have to do a lot of work on your website. So if that's something that you want to do, again, submit a ticket to support. They'll give you instructions on how to make this better and get some of that sample content back. So Katie says, which template design do you think is the best one and why? I don't really have a preference. When it comes to the templates, I don't like the ones that have the menus on the left. So Zest and Health Coach Pro are not my favorites. I'm just not a big fan of those menus on the left. Other than that, I don't have a preference at all. Roseanne says, how do you view the new ones? There really isn't a great resource for that. There's this link I can give you. This is very similar to when you order your site. You can kind of hover over each one and you can preview it and see a live demo that lets you walk through what the site looks like. So that's pretty much it. But again, like I said, there's, if you have one of the original ones, if you have Foodie Bonanza or Zest or Forks and Spoons, I don't think there's really anything that is worth changing the template for, you know, in my personal opinion. Like I said, you can do a lot with the templates. I'll give you an example. So our most recent series, I used a new template. So I used the Savor one. So this is what Savor looks like when you order it up. Nice looking template. Our latest series, we went through and changed it to look like this. So, this is what our most recent webinar series is. I went through and changed all of the pages and so on. So, our previous series before that, we started with Forks and Spoons. Which everybody, oh, that's the wrong one. Everybody knows what forks and spoons look like. So let me pull that one up. So we started with forks and spoons, which looks like this. And we finished with... this. Same website, same template, looks 100% different. So, I mean, you can do a lot with the templates, and it really doesn't matter which one you have. So, Roseanne says, since I have forks and spoons, is there any way to place my resources, etc., in another area outside than other than the header, like it's its own separate content box? I'm not sure what you mean. What do you mean place your resources? Like your menu? Your menu is doesn't matter which template you're on. Your menu is where it is. You can't change that. That's where it is in the template. That's where it stays. You don't have the option to move those around someplace. So... Annalena says, real quick, where do I change the size of the letters from the menu? When you are logged into the site, if you go into your design tab, and if you go to your colors section, the first listing is menu, and that is where you can select your font and the font size. So again, I would recommend when you start doing that stuff, create a new preset first and then go through and make those changes, so you can always have a fallback if you need to. My menu is in the header box, but I don't see that on the original Forks and Spoons template. The menu is always in the same place. Menu is right up here. I don't have anything on this template because I don't have anything in my main menu. There's nothing in it. So if I were to move stuff into my main menu, for example, there's my menu up here. I can't move that. That's where it is. It's gonna stay there. I don't have any option to move that. Then I ask, the templates have the same amount of sections, columns, and areas. What would you say the main differences are from the three new ones? They do kind of have the same basic structure to them, but not really. So, for example, in Forks and Spoons, my sections and so on my homepage are laid out like this, to give you different areas and options for customizing things. On the Saver template, close this, which is one of the newer templates, if I can spell correctly. When I go into edit mode, I see the same basic premise, but I also have some different sections like these. These are kind of the main feature. These sections that are right up next to each other like that, these are what are called gutterless sections. There's no space between them like there are here. You'll see that here. That's pretty much the only difference. Otherwise, we try to give you as many different options as far as content areas and where things are placed, so you have a lot of different options and abilities to organize the content however you see fit. So... that would be, in my opinion, the main difference with the templates. The new templates have these gutterless sections that can be right up next to each other. Other than that, that's about it. So, you are welcome, Roseanne. Any other final questions, comments, concerns? Like I said, the video for today's session, by the end of the day, for sure, will be uploaded. It'll be accessible in the support portal. It'll be the first video listed in the webinar video gallery. You'll be able to see it in the webinar video gallery section. It'll be the first one, be right above webinar series update for the recipe app. And you can go through and watch it, scroll through it, check out any of the answers from the questions and stuff. Analia says, from the submenu, I did not find how to change that font. That's going to be in the same section, but it's also, whatever your submenu is, it's going to take the font settings for your menu. So you're not going to be able to pick different font settings. So whatever you have for your menu is going to be the same for your submenus. So you can't pick one font for one and one for the other. Yeah, they do that for consistency's sake. I mean, you generally wouldn't want your submenu to be that drastically different. I mean, you can change the color schemes and stuff, which works out nicely. But you wouldn't want necessarily to have different font there. I can show you the one that we did for this. We did the same thing where the font is the same, but the colors change as you highlight over it. Kind of makes them stand out a little bit more. So, Roseanne asks, can we get a copy of the chat answers and the QA questions? Unfortunately, no. There isn't a hard copy of that. So, and Diana says, does the Health Coach Pro template have a lot of those sections that are close to each other, the gutter sections? I don't know if it has a lot. It has some. I mean, it depends on what page you're looking at, but there are some. This homepage specifically does not have any, but I think it's going to depend on what page that you're on for that particular template. So, like the inside page has a section just like that where there's a lot of the gutterless sections. Francis says, I was just looking at the new template. Is there a way to add the info on the form section onto my Foodie Bonanza template? I'm not sure what you mean here. This? Is that what you're talking about, Francis? All of the templates come with the same content. So, like all this stuff, these forms and everything, it all comes with the same stuff. The pictures are different. These pictures don't come with, you know, the older templates, but you can get those pictures. I believe they're all taken from the content manager. But your forms page is the same. So it's the same. Yeah, it's the same text on your templates, just the pictures are different. So, but most of these pictures were taken from the content manager, I believe. So should be able to find them. But otherwise, all the sample text on any page on any of the templates is all the same. So it's been set up on that way on purpose. So all of this stuff is 100% the same from template to template. Any other questions? Well, I hope that you all found today's session helpful and that I was able to answer the questions that you did have. We had a lot of good questions today, so that's good. Hopefully, I was able to give you the resources and the answers that you need to help answer them. Diana says, one more, which have menus on the left? Zest and Health Coach Pro. Shirley says, well, when I move the text button, I notice that it doesn't stick in some areas. Why is that? So you just have to make sure that you're placing it in the right spot. So if you're dragging your text area, when you place it, you see that it's highlighting a section that indicates where it's going to be placed. Sometimes it's a little finicky. It doesn't highlight the section that you want it to go into. That's okay. You can just go ahead and add in your text anyway. You can always move it. So like I can take this text and I can move it wherever I want at any point in time. So sometimes it's a little finicky, but for the most part, you'll get there. But you have to make sure that you have a section highlighted like this. Otherwise, it's not going to place anything. So you have to select where it's going to go before you can place it. And that applies to any content, whether it's text or an image or anything. You are welcome. Katie says that I learned a lot today. Thank you. You are welcome. Glad you learned a lot today. Roseanne asks, once I begin blogging, how do I link that to my Facebook page? That particular feature, there used to be an option where you could go in and link your blog to automatically post to Facebook. Facebook changes their stuff a lot, and their most recent change kind of actually broke that. So there isn't a way to easily do that. So if you want to, what I would suggest you do is when you create a blog post, every blog post that you have, and I will show you here. Every blog post that you have has what's called a permalink to it, which is just a link for the blog post. Just copy that link and post it on your Facebook page. So every time you create a blog, you have a blog on your website, you can just copy this link and post that on your Facebook page. And it'll put up a little preview of the blog and a link to it. Which is the exact same thing. It's a little bit more manual, but it looks a lot better. So it'll look just like this. So like here's the American Spirit blog. There's the blog, a little information along with that permalink, and there's a little preview for that blog post. So it's very nice and clean, and it looks very good. So that's what I would suggest. All right. Well, I think we can wrap it up for today. We've had a very long session, which is great. A lot of good questions. So Annalena says, I see people comment on the blog and I cannot see the comments and I cannot respond to them. Tell me how. When you set up your blog, there is a section on settings. So when you go to your blog section in your dashboard, there's a section for settings. There's a section for comments. Do you want to allow people to comment? Yes. Do you want to do moderations? If you select yes, that means you have to approve every comment that's submitted. There's also a section on comments. So I can actually click here and see the comments that are there. I can delete them if I want to, and so on. As far as replying, if you want to reply to a comment, so if there's somebody leaves a comment on a blog, click on this one. If somebody comments, you can comment back. just go to the blog post and comment. So, like that. That's how that works. There isn't a way for you to respond to their comments privately, I don't believe. So, Roseanne asks, will my blog automatically have my favicon? Yes. You actually have the option in your blog settings, I believe, when you are looking at your sidebar. You have the choice to change the image here. You can add an image here. If you don't add an image, it's going to display your favicon by default. And then you can choose yes or no if you want to save that, to show that. So, Katie asks, is there a way to be notified when someone comments on your blog? In your settings on the comments portion, I think the only way to do that would be to set the moderation on. I think. I don't think there's a way to have the settings to notify you anytime someone comments. I think you actually have to turn the moderation on, I believe. But if you turn moderations on, and you'll see here when I do it, then you enter in your email address. And then you'll get an email notification saying that somebody's left that comment. And then you come into the comment section, and you can view it, and you can say yes or no. So. Anything else? Okay. Well, I think we can wrap it up for today then. Like I said, lots of great questions. Hopefully I was able to give you guys the answers you're looking for, or at least point you in the right direction. Roseanne has a question. The way that I get to my lab ed editing site is from the original email. Is there an easy way? Yes. Just go to your website and type in /login. That's how you log in. So whatever your website name is, bookmark it. So you can go there anytime that you want. So just, but then at the end of your URL, just type in /login and sign in. Can do it from anywhere. You don't need to access that email at all. So, you are very welcome. But yeah, hopefully I was able to answer your questions and at least point you guys in the right directions. Like I said, the support portal has a lot of excellent resources. You can do searches for your questions, topics, and so on. Point you in the right direction. We also do the webinars every Thursday. I think next week we're going to take a break. Maybe the next 2 weeks we might take a break, but next week for sure. But we always send out emails and stuff to let you know what's coming up as far as the topics and so on. So you can always stay tuned. And like I said, the videos are always available. You can watch them whenever you want, as many times as you want. So hopefully you find that helpful. And like I said, today's video will be available by the end of the day, so you can always go back and rewatch the stuff that we covered and see the answers and so on. And hopefully it'll make you feel a little bit more confident in your website. So I know it can be frustrating and so on, but I can promise you, you know, take a little bit at a time, and with some time and some practice, it'll get easier. So I was once in the same position as all of you. So Dinah says, thank you for your time and direction. You are very welcome. Happy to do it. But with that said, I think we'll call it a day. Again, I want to thank you for your time and your patience, and hopefully you found it helpful. So enjoy the rest of your day. Enjoy the rest of your week and your weekend, and hopefully we will see you again next time. Thanks, everyone.